much. Yes, I'm very excited to be here today, and thank you so much for the organizers. And will it work? Okay, so just an overview of how the talk is going to look like. I'm going to start by presenting the existing debate about the richness of conscious perception, and I'm going to briefly overview some of the evidence supporting the rich and the sparse accounts of consciousness. And then we're going to get from there to how free reports were suggested as a way to reflect visual perception and maybe even support the richness hypothesis. And from that, we're going to get to a new metric that was suggested, inspired by that idea and our examination of it. And hopefully we're going to have time to discuss before you all run to pee or have more coffee or. So when we talk about the richness of conscious perception, we actually narrow it down even further to the richness of conscious visual perception. And then it boils down to the question of what do we consciously see? And one of the answers is that intuitively you want to say a lot or all of it or many, many things. Conscious experience is extremely rich, it's extremely detailed, it resonates very well with our intuition of what we see when we open our eyes in the morning. And that is one answer. But another answer is that, well, not so much, that conscious experience is actually very sparse and very limited. And then when we think about it, it also kind of makes sense, knowing what we know about other cognitive processes, such as memory or attention and their limitations. And then we think about visual information processes in the brain, and then it also makes sense. And interestingly, the tension between these two perspectives has yet to lead to any conclusion or a coherent account for this very seemingly stupid question, what do we consciously see? And this tension is very interesting, and I argue relevant for where the field is right now. First of all, because we are all aiming to explain phenomenal consciousness and understand better what it is and characterize it, and having an account of the richness of conscious visual perception can actually help us with that, help us better characterize and maybe refine what we mean. We have heard from many people that maybe we're not sure what we even mean when you talk about it, and maybe the question of richness can help. Also, we have heard and seen this proliferation of theories of consciousness in the field. These are just a few examples of attempts to map them. I'm sure you've also heard of examples of attempts to make them fight each other or whatever phrasing you want to put that in. And an account for the richness of conscious perception can actually help us with that too, because it can push theories of consciousness to making testable predictions about their accounts of what do we consciously see, how rich conscious experience is. They will have to explain that and account for that. And we can also indirectly limit models of consciousness, because an account for the richness of conscious experience might also help us define the interplay between consciousness and processes such as attention, such as memory. So this is interesting, and also I'm not the only one thinking that. People are still talking about it. There are new works about it all the time. This is just from like a couple of months ago. So, other than talking about it, what evidence has been collected over the years for the richness and sparseness accounts? So evidence for the sparseness hypothesis mainly stems from this type of paradigms, where we fail to notice things that are right in front of us. And this is pretty astounding for those who never seen the gorilla experiment, I just ruined it for you, but it's for the first time that you see those things, you kind of cannot believe how much you miss things that are right in front of you. And both in change and in attentional blindness, the overarching idea is that when you don't attend to something, you fail to notice it, no matter how salient it is, no matter how central it is. And of course, once you do attend to it, you can easily see it. And this has been interpreted as evidence for the sparseness hypothesis, because it shows us just how much we miss. The problem with that, though, is that all of these are based on manipulating consciousness via manipulations of attention. And as long as we don't know and we have yet to reach a conclusion about whether or not consciousness and attention are doubly dissociated, if they are doubly dissociated, manipulating attention doesn't mean that we manipulated consciousness. So when I fail to notice something, I might have not failed to have a conscious experience of it and see it, and the attentional failure might come later. So this is a limitation of this line of evidence for the sparseness hypothesis. But evidence for the richness hypothesis is also in a pickle, because all of the evidence that is conceived to be supporting the account that the conscious experience is immensely rich is basically based on variants of this paradigm, the partial report paradigm, originated by George Sperling. So participants see an array, it disappears, and then they need to report all the letters that they can remember. This is a full report condition. In the partial report condition, the array disappears, and then they hear a tone, and this tone is actually a cue for a specific row in the array, and they need to report all the letters that they can remember from that specific row. And what George Sperling originally did, it was based on the accuracy of those reports, calculated the number of available letters, and found that in the partial report condition, the number of available letters was higher than it was in the full report condition. And even though the original experiment by Sperling did not talk about consciousness or its richness, it was phrased as iconic memory and taken as such, later it was interpreted as evidence supporting the richness hypothesis. Supports the view that visual experience has a rich content, phenomenal consciousness has far greater capacity than access consciousness. The fact that you could be cued to retain any item specifically supports believing that even specific unretained items are phenomenally conscious. And there are specific problems with the original paradigm, but over the years, there have been many, many variants developed inspired by it. To name a few, the Amsterdam paradigm by Victor Lame's group, and the color diversity variant from Marius Usher's group. The details here are less important because all of these have the same fallacy, have the same limitation. The results of the performance of observers in all of these tasks can be completely explained without consciousness at all. Unconscious processing can account for participants' performance when they are asked, for example, about the color diversity of the non-cued rows. You don't arguably need to have a conscious experience of all the letters and all their colors to report the overall color diversity. Same here, unconscious processing in the Sperling paradigm, the tone, the cue, might have lifted into consciousness something that was previously processed without consciousness at all. Doesn't mean that Hugh had phenomenal experience of it to begin with. And this is a very big limitation on this line of evidence for the richness hypothesis. And it was very frustrating for proponents of the richness hypothesis. If our intuitions about rich visual experience have more validity than the sparse account, because we are putting the hat of proponents of the richness hypothesis right now, how can we better estimate this richness? And from this frustration came a suggestion of loosening the straitjacket of simple discrimination tasks. So in all of the tasks we usually ask participants to do in psychological experiments, not just evidence for the sparseness hypothesis, also for the sparseness, the richness, all of them, we ask people, did you see something, yes or no? We ask them to select one item out of four. We ask them to report one letter out of 20 something, depending on the language that you speak. This is a very, very narrow space of possibilities for participants to report. And they say, how can we possibly understand the richness of conscious perception when this is all participants can provide us with? So they suggest in that paper, they refer to a 2007 work by Feifei and colleagues, where they had participants view scenes and write what they saw. And this is a figure from the paper by Feifei. The original paper actually did something a bit different. They categorized their responses. But what Han and colleagues claim about this work is that even by looking at this figure, you can see that when a participant is presented with something that is about 100 milliseconds long, they can still write a full paragraph about their experience of it. So if we just let people say what they saw, we might be able to uncover the true richness of a conscious perceptual experience. Why don't we do that? And my answer to this is because I don't think it's a good idea. So in case we don't get to the end, and I will spend the rest of the talk trying to convince you to agree with me. And I'm not a physicist or a mathematician or a philosopher. So as an experimentalist, the way I'm gonna need to support my claim is with data. So I'm using this experiment, which was inspired by this suggestion. And in this experiment by Chuyin and colleagues, what they did is they participants viewed scenes for a brief amount of time, and then they were asked to report freely five words that describe their experience of those scene, and rate their confidence in each and every one of the words. And based on that, they calculated a metric that they called intersubjective agreement, or IA, that quantifies how specific a word is with respect to the image that it was provided for. I'm not going to get into the specifics of the calculation of IA, both because of time constraints, but also because it doesn't matter for the overarching point that I want to make. This is sort of a specificity metric. They take the reports for images, and they compare how frequent was this word for this image compared to all the other images in the stimulus set. And what they say is, well, if those descriptions are global and they are coarse, we expect those word IAs to be low because we expect them to be shared across the images. But what they found was that the word IAs were very, very high. One is the maximum, and most of the words had very high IA scores. And from that, not only did they say that it means that this word IA metric captures an aspect of conscious perception, they went a step further and says that it agrees with the richness hypothesis account of conscious perception. And what I did in my work is to ask, well, does it? And the reasoning that I had was that if it does capture conscious perception, it should go with it. For example, when I degrade it, this metric should go down. So for example, when I take out the focus, the details, or when I take away the color, based on that reasoning, I expect the word IAs to be lower than they are in the original data set of pictures. So this is what I did. I replicated the experiment. I also ran it with the blurred stimuli and the black and white stimuli. I did it once, then I pre-registered it and did it all over again. So these are six experiments. And the question is, did IA consistently go down? And the answer is no, it didn't. And not only that it didn't, actually in the black and white version of the images, word IAs were higher than they were in the other experiment. So IA did not consistently go down with degraded perception. I will put an asterisk on this for the skeptics. We had control experiments, two control experiments, to actually verify that indeed those manipulations degraded conscious percepts of the images. So it did not go down, but I found it was very consistent with another thing, which is the frequency of words in the English language in general. So the more a word was found to be specific to the image that it was describing, this is the IA metric, the more unique the word was in the English vocabulary, regardless of any specific perception of an image, across all six experiments. So it's not consistent with degraded perception. It is very consistent with language, but I was missing something. We were like asking participants to provide all of these words, and we were counting them and aggregating them, but we neglected something very important, which is their actual content, what the participants actually said. So what we did next was to look at those words and see what did the participants actually say for each and every image. And of course, we found words that are existing in the picture. They, like cow or man, these are tangible things that are clearly seen in the scene that they were describing. But we also found non-existing words, which are words that do not describe something that appears in the image. Maybe it's because they're conceptual, like fun or romantic or scary or some sort of an appreciation that is not perceptual at all. Maybe it's because what we call insertion. So these are words that do describe tangible objects that were consistent with the gist of the image, but the actual object was not there. Maybe they were confusion words, which are words that describe objects that do not appear in the image and that they're not consistent with the gist of the image. But if you squint, you can see how these satellites can look like sails, and then boat kind of makes sense. So this would have been like an insertion word for the wrong gist of the image. And lastly, there were a couple of like completely unrelated words that did not fall to any of the other categories. And if we ask about the relationship to conscious perception, of course, we ignore these two because they're not interesting to begin with respect to what they consciously perceived. And we are looking at these words, and not only did these words exist and we found them consistently in all six experiments, these words also had very high were the A scores. They were provided by at least two participants, because this is how the metric is calculated. So these are not like spurious random words. They were provided consistently. And it is clear that this helicopter is neither a whale nor a bee, but it happened in all experiments. So while most of the words that were provided for an image did exist in it, about a third for each and every image did not. And many were conceptual. And out of that, about a third were consistently insertion and confusion words. So summary of the findings is that this wasn't consistent with perception, it was with vocabulary. And when we look at the content of the words, we see those insertion words. So from that, I concluded that this is not a perceptual metric. But then I want to explain what it might mean. So one, obvious explanation due to the consistent relationship to language is that this is sort of a variable metric that captures some language regularities, and it's not related to perceived content. Another option, if we take into account the insertion words, is that participants briefly view those like many, many scenes. They had just perception of all of them, and they guessed. The strategy was basically guessing based on perceiving the semantic content. Most of the time, they were right, because existing words can also be successful guesses. Some of the times, they were wrong. But to that, someone can say, well, what if I believe every single word that was provided, that it describes some percept? What if it's not just like just perception? What if they actually did see a fence? What if they actually did see a paper? Fine. My trouble with it is that based on the words alone, we will not be able to know that. We will not be able to know the perceived contents if we look at those words. So this is what leads to the conclusion that those verbal descriptions do not capture the detail of conscious experience, because we cannot really verify that. And it kind of makes sense when we think about it, about the language in general, because if experience is so rich and so detailed that it is beyond memory, beyond attention, all of these things, language is serial. It relies on memory. It takes a hell of a lot of time to produce. Language is also conceptual, sort of a zip compressor of things into concepts we can easily communicate with one another. So it kind of makes sense that if we are proponents of this overflow argument, it will overflow language as well. So I, to not end with a completely grim note, I don't think that this is sort of a lost cause, but I do think that when we come to suggest ways to measure or characterize the richness of conscious perception, no matter which side we're on, we need to sort of take into account that we have this burden to demonstrate that it is connected to perception rather than other possible things, and that we're able to disentangle that. And with that, I thank you. And
thank you very much.